Hi, my name is Tony Antun. I'm a director of development in Microsoft. I work in the Office division, the division that brought you the Office suite, the productivity applications, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Outlook, OneNote for the last 30 years. Some of you are old enough to remember these. Some of you are young enough to start working on them. I was talking with Herb Sutter in Microsoft, and he was like, hey, how are you guys are doing this cross-platform thing? Are you guys using some C++? Can you kind of like summarize it for me in a minute or two? And I was like, well, you know, Herb, that's something that I need like an hour or two to tell you about. He was like, great, I've signed you up for a presentation. We're doing CPP, come on, so come on over. So he slipped me a Mickey on that one. Honestly, the topic is really important, and if you're in our hallways, in our buildings, you'll find like every bunch of four or five developers talking about one aspect of it. So welcome to CPPCon, that used to be going native. I hope there are no HTML developers here. We're all native, we're all C++ guys here. Yeah, but we are friendly to HTML developers, yeah, that's for sure. What are we going to talk about today? Actually, we have just like four parts. The first part is we're going to give you a brief history of Microsoft Office. Now, the title sounds a little bit boring, but actually there's a really important point to it, and it's short. Microsoft Office has been in development for close to 30 years. There's a lot of learnings there. We've went on the cross-plat curve multiple times. Sometimes certain things worked, sometimes certain things did not work. There was a lot of awesome innovation in it and a lot of lessons to share with you guys. Then we will talk about 5 to 10 minutes about what are the requirements of cross-platform today. This is about how the ecosystem is developing, what are the platforms, the form factors, all the influencing factors, and what kind of tension it creates for a bunch of engineers to deliver a product as big as Office for cross-platform. Then it gets super exciting. That's when we get into the technical strategy and the technical implementations. That's why you guys paid to come here. So that's gonna be probably half of the first hour. And then the last hour, it's all code. So we're gonna take a deep dive into what we've learned while taking hundreds of millions of lines of code, trying to put them on multiple platforms, and we're gonna talk about, hey, on this compiler, watch out for this thing. When you're using this library, watch out for that thing. Watch out with the linkers. Watch out with byte alignment issues. Avoid these APIs. Use these APIs. Hey, if you're mixing Objective-C with C++, what do you need to do? What worked for us? What did not work for us as well? So with that, and there's always a last slide, so we're gonna call it final thoughts. So let's get started with the brief history of Office apps. Let me introduce my fellow colleague, Igor. He's a distinguished engineer in Office, and he will talk to you about the history of Office.
After you get plugged in. So thank you, Tony, for introduction. Welcome. So I've got to actually watch the Dropbox presentation right before that, which was very interesting because the presentation was a little bit different from ours, because in a Dropbox talk it was a group of iOS developers coming from Objective-C and a group of Java developers coming from Java and trying to build a shared cross-platform code base, learning all of the good things about C++ and how you can use it to build cross-platform applications. For us, it's a little bit different because we actually started from C, so it was really nice to attend this talk before starting. So Office, again, some of you might be old enough when Office was originally shipped. I don't think that I actually was old enough to care about the first Office application when it was released. So our code base is about, actually it's slightly older than 30 years. And 30 years is a very, very, very long time. Even by human standard, it's certainly a very old time by a software project standard. So the going joke on an Office team is that our code base is old enough to buy its own alcohol and have kids. And in fact, most of the people who work on it now are younger than the code base. So just going briefly through what happened with Office. It all started as a set of separate applications. They were originally all written in C. And Microsoft Word has been released for DOS in 1993, end of 1993, so it's not that old. So this guy on the left, some of you might know, his name is Charles Simony. He was one of the original developers on Xerox PARC Bravo, probably the first, I think it was the first real VisiVig document editor. He is inventor of Hungarian notation. So people who read and see long enough know what it is. So it's how do you make basically not type safe code be semi type safe, and it generates wonderful variable name and functional names. It's just fantastic when you first come to Microsoft and start reading Hungarian notation. It's really good for training your memory and text comprehension. You can't see the letters, I don't think, but actually if you read them carefully, what you would notice is that Microsoft Word for DOS was developed on Unix. That's because I would assume Charles Simony liked Unix. So in 85, Apple released Macintosh. We actually released our apps to Macintosh, so that was our first foray into cross-platform. We didn't do a particularly good job of being like very holistically cross-platform at that point. We've shipped for Windows, of course, when Windows showed up. Again, don't know whether you see the numbers, but the astonishing thing when I was inserting this screenshot is that on a machine that has 1 megabyte of memory, half of the megabyte is free. And that includes operating system and actual like VisiVig version of Microsoft Word. So I wish our software was this small now. In 1990, we actually bundled applications for the first time together called the Microsoft Office, but none of the code was shared, so they were just separate apps, but users love them. What do almost all software products that ship their first version, get a lot of users, get a lot of excitement around them, what all of them do? Well, they decide to rewrite everything because we are now so smart and so successful, of course, we know how to design spreadsheets and presentations and everything. We can do a much better job. So we'll solve all of the architectural problems. And by the way, the pyramid is very intentional. Here, the code name of the project was Pyramid. So the new thing is going to be so much better architected. It, by the way, going to be a cross-platform in a way where we will have single code base for like Word and Excel that is going to dual target Windows and Mac. We'll use C++. So we see plus 2.0, it was cross-plat, so it was able to generate Windows and Mac code, so it was super exciting. So what usually happens when you try to do that?
It fails.
Exactly. So the thing that happens, and that's actually a very important theme for the presentation, is that you so over-focus on the specific architectural problems that are bugging you that you completely forget about all of the good things your code base already does. And you only remember about this when you try to rewrite it. And then you realize that you need years to rewrite it. So we had some smart managers. They've canceled the project. So a lot of people cried, but we actually salvaged a few things. So some of the architectural bits, actually the single code base we've salvaged as well. So Microsoft Word 6.0 was a product that was done, I believe in, I will misquote it, but it was done in under a year, and it was done by a team that was building the canceled Pyramid project. And the product was very successful. It was one of the most successful version of Word ever. It basically just closed the whole discussion of competition in the Word processor space. So it was awesome, it was amazing. How well did the Mac product do? And it was highly shared code base. Actually, we did an amazing job. There were some feats of engineering. So Mac product did not do very well. So it was slow. Users complained that it looks like Windows app running on a Macintosh. It had some weird reliability issues that the Windows product just didn't have. And like the consensus even on the team was that it basically just outright sucked. So people who worked on it were embarrassed by the result. A little bit further in the talk, there are actually explanations of what we've learned from this experience, what we've done differently and wrong again, and what we are doing now. Now it's going to be right. So lots of other things have happened since that time. So like Windows NT shipped, Windows 95 shipped, so we went from 16-bit to 32 bits. That was a big change for the code base. We went to Unicode. That was another big change to the code base, because when you write in editors, you operate with text everywhere. So it was a pretty significant redesign. Then came Office 97. We've actually decided that it's time to share code, that if you have three applications that all have toolbars, it's kind of embarrassing that you've written them three times. So it took us this long to finally do that, but we did a pretty good job. We had shared teams that started to develop libraries that are used by everyone. We've started to use C++, but sort of naively, not using exceptions, no STL. PowerPoint is the only exception. PowerPoint team has always cared deeply about the quality of their code, more deeply than everyone else. I didn't try to say that the rest of us did not care about the quality of our code, not to the same degree of attention to detail. So they actually went to C++ in 92, and they went all the way, sometimes too much of the way. So they were pioneers of using template code in Office in a way that is not necessarily quality code. So we added COM, we added VBA, and then we added innovation of the decade. We added Clippy. So and the quote is, "I see you are trying to take over the world. Can I help you?" So, and we thought that it's going to help us, and not sure whether it worked out that way. So one thing that we didn't ship in Office 97, for people who remember that, is we actually didn't ship Mac version of Office 97, because we were so embarrassed by our Mac Word 6.0 experience that we've decided that our users never going to forgive us for doing this again. So what we've done is we've actually created a different team. So Tony is now leading this team that is specifically tasked with making Office awesome on Mac. So they have to be the macOS experts. They should optimize for performance on the macOS. They should build UI that is awesome on a Mac, not just a generic UI. And they shipped Mac Office 98. It took them about 12 months, I think, after you shipped Office 97. And this was a very successful product. So actually, it's sort of redeemed our credibility with Mac product. It helped Apple as well. Because if you remember, Apple didn't do very well in 98, so it actually was very important for them that we would ship this product. One unfortunate thing happened is that we actually lost the cross-platform code base. Like, we've sort of went from let's share everything to let's share everything but copy of everything. So that was a little unfortunate. We'll talk more about this later. And lots of other things have happened. It's a long list, and a lot of those are just what was happening with the industry. So we've shipped Pocket Office. So if somebody remembers Pocket PC, Mac version of Office went through a lot of different toolchain changes. They went to GCC, they went to Clang. We've completely changed our UI, went from toolbars and menus and dialogs to ribbons and side panes and still dialogs, because it was impossible to get rid of them, too many. We've shipped web applications, so there is a web version, HTML version of Office as well. We have not going to talk about that in this talk, but we actually sharing some code with that version as well. And on the Windows side, we're now on VC14 version of the compiler. And we've killed Clippy. And that was another innovation of the detail. So we've got 2-for-1 with a single feature. So actually the email that was sent when that would happen was just hilarious. Because you can imagine how much fun people who worked on this had with both creating the thing and then killing the thing. So another big thing that happened in the industry is obviously mobile devices. So iPhone, Android, iPad. So like VR is the most widely used productivity application, so we have to be on all of those platforms. So right now we've shipped version for iPad about 3.5 months ago. I think that we have something like 35 million downloads, which is not too bad. We've moved to modern C++, or rather we are moving to a modern C++. We were looking for the switch where you just flip the switch and you're modern, so we didn't really find it. And most of the team is working on version of Office for Android and for WinRT. And some of the lessons that we are going to talk about are from this work. So if I was in your place, I would actually ask, so why I'm talking about all of this, how is this relevant to a C++ conference, a lot of the history. But the point that we were trying to make is that the only reason why all of this was possible were We are building class-leading applications for 30 years. We've been able to not only ship those applications, but evolve them is because we've picked C++. We think that we've just tremendously lucked out because all of the other languages that I know, runtimes I know, two categories of things would have happened if we've picked them. And there are a lot of projects that went through that. One is the language would have been reinvented three times and we would have had to rewrite everything three times. So that's one extreme. Another extreme, the authors of the language and the industry would have lost interest. And then it would have stagnated and we would be dead. And C++ was really the only language that I know that had the longevity to allow us to do that. So I'll show you some code just for fun to actually demonstrate this. So you won't be able to read it, so don't strain your eyes because it's more to illustrate the point. So this is actually a core editing function in Word. So the way Word works is it has what we call piece table. That all of the data is immutable. When you make edits, it gets injected in the piece table. So insert a new thing in a piece table so that we put the content there. So that function is from 1989. So the function on the right is the same function that I basically took from the code base yesterday while preparing for that. And two interesting things to illustrate the point is that you can clearly see like green stuff is basically identical code. Like red stuff, I think that we've changed, and the bluish stuff, it's sort of different, but it doesn't matter that it's different. So what you'll notice here is that, well, obviously we went from a Kernighan and Ricci C with all of the weird type notations to like a normal C. Another thing that you'll notice is that we used to like global variables, and well, global variables are a bad idea, so we don't use global variables anymore. Another thing, if you're really careful, that you'll notice is that we used to not care about security, now we do. So we use unsigned integers where necessary, and we do a more careful job with math. But the point is that we've refactored stuff that actually had to be modernized about our code base, but the design is rock solid. Like we think that that's one of the better designs for an editor, so we kept that. So that's the history of Office. So hopefully we've preached enough to the C++ audience that C++ is awesome, and it's great that it evolved. So next part of the presentation is going to be about cross-platform. So as you've probably already like noticed is that Office was cross-platform from the very beginning. We've done it in a couple of different ways. We've failed in a few different ways. We've succeeded in a few different ways. We've learned that not sharing code is bad, that's obvious. Sharing all of the code is just as bad, that's a little bit less obvious, but it is bad. And that C++ is a great enabler, and I'll actually give the microphone back to Tony, and he'll talk about what's going on with cross-platform right now, different requirements, and thanks.
That works, I'll use this one. Okay, so what are the cross-platform requirements today and particularly for productivity suite like Office? You're all developers, you're building an app or multiple apps, could be a small one and big one. In this new hybrid world, each one of you have multiple devices. If you want high usage, you want your app to be on all those platforms and all those form factors. And that begs the question of, well, how do I go about doing this? And if you're writing your code from scratch, well, you have some sort of advantages and certain approaches, but if you have a legacy rich code base, you might have to take different approaches. As with all software solutions, you have to start with what's your business strategy, what is your product requirements. That would influence highly your technical strategy, and then you will make your choice on what programming languages you're gonna use. In our choice, it's very easy, it's C++. But let me talk a little bit about what are the product goals at a really high level, and then we'll connect them to why we chose C++ and why C++ is actually the best choice for it. So the first thing is, naturally, we want Office to be available everywhere, on all the major platforms. So we want it to be on Windows, whether it's Win32 or WinRT. We want it to be on Apple, iOS, OS X, iPad, iPhone, Mac. We want it to be on the Androids. We want it to be on the web as well. Anywhere that a customer needs to use an Office document, whatever his device of choice is, we want Office to be there for him. we want content fidelity across all these platforms and devices. This is extremely critical for the business value of Office. You want your document to just work. You don't care what's the form factor, what's the screen, what's the OS, what's the APIs. You want your document to work, high fidelity, you view it, you edit it, you work with it, and it just works. That's very critical for us. We want market-leading experience on every one of those platforms. We could easily go with the lowest common denominator technical solution and say, yep, we can probably even get it a little bit faster and then crap load of maintenance for years and years and years, but the experience would not be high quality. Historically, Office has always delivered a high productivity, high fidelity, high experience for the customer, and that stays true, regardless of how the ecosystem changes. And we want velocity of innovation. Platforms are moving, they're evolving. Today, there is this new feature here on this platform gets this other feature, we want an Office productivity suite to actually take advantage of these platform capabilities. And we don't want to leave a lot of gaps between the offering on all the platforms, so we wanna be iterating really quickly. So what does that mean for us? It means we have to look at the ecosystem and say, well, okay, I understand all these product goals. Now, what are the influencing factors across the ecosystem that I have to take into account when a bunch of engineers sit on the table and try to massage hundreds of millions of lines of code? Well, you got the platforms. You got the Windows, the Apple, the Android, the web. They're all on the table. They're all first-class platforms. We need to take care of them. We got the APIs. You got, oh, well, on Windows, there's a difference between Win32 and WinRT, and guess what? They're not similar. On Apple platform, well, iOS and OS X, they're kind of 80% the same, but there are some differences. You got the form factors, the phone, the tablet, the desktop, the large screen, so you need to start to think about, well, dynamic UX, layout, things like that. And today, there was the announcement of iWatch. So we need to see, I don't know if we're gonna support this one. I was like, yeah, I mean, you're like, can I write a formula here? We will see, it should be cool. Yeah, we're all laughing, it's gonna be hilarious if next year we need to support it. we have different UX models. You have the traditional mouse and keyboard, and no, they're not dead, and they're still super useful. You guys developers know that really well. And you got the touch interface as well. You get the compute. Where do you put it? Is it on the client or is it on the cloud? Old days, there used to be mainframes, and you have dummy terminals, and we said, like, no, the PC is really smart, and we're going to put a lot of horsepower on it, and you can do a lot of things on the PC. Now we're like, wait, we got the cloud. You can move a lot of compute there, and it helps you with consistency as well. So you look at all these factors, and we're like, okay, there's definitely going to be technical tensions and risks here. How do we look at them? Well, the quality of the experience is extremely important. As I said, we want a rich experience. We do not want a lowest common denominator. We want the platform integration to be actually easy, low cost. So some of the direction that we take is to go with native frameworks, like UX frameworks on the platform. We want consistency of the functionality. So if you try to differentiate on one platform and you add a particular feature, feature X on, let's say, I don't know, Windows, we discovered that actually users, after a while, they stop using it because they don't have it on iOS or they might not have it on Android and in the web. So that's not really a great choice. We gotta be careful about these things. You can still fine tune a particular feature and maximize it on a particular platform, but we're shying away from saying, feature X exists on this platform, but feature X does not exist on that platform. We want to get out of that business. We want consistency of the experience. As I said, the biggest business value for Office is the document itself and the content fidelity. So things like the document, the artifacts, the protocols, we want 100% consistency as best as we can. That's very, very, very critical. We've went to certain measures where our actually app developers sort of play the OS developers to move certain functionality from one platform to another so we can duplicate it, so we can keep this fidelity. It's that hard for us. You will find, for example, in Office iPad that later the guys in the next session will talk to you about it and give you details that we moved actually some stuff from Windows headers and put them on iOS and made them work in fantastic ways. They'll get you the details. We also want app consistency. And what we mean by that is kind of a two-pronged thing. First, you want actually an app to be consistent with the other apps on the platform in that ecosystem. So we want PowerPoint on an iPad to look like any other app on an iPad. We do not want a Windows PowerPoint on iOS. That would look ugly. We've tried it. It looks really ugly. So we had to redesign it from the ground up. But we also want PowerPoint to look like PowerPoint on Android, on iOS, on Windows, on the web. You launch it, and you don't need somebody to tell you it's PowerPoint. You look at it, it's like, yep, yep, that's PowerPoint. Your muscle memory gets activated, and you start using it. And believe me, guys, it's hard to get these two. It's really hard. We want consistency of the release timing as well. Significant release versions skew across the platforms will inherently cause functionality skew. We want them to stay close. As I said earlier, we want the user to access certain features on an iPhone device, but then go to his Surface and find that they're there. It's the same thing. And he doesn't have to wait 6 to 9 months to get that capability. So what is the solution for such a thing? Well, Igor and I, we went and we said, hey, let's ask the search engines out there. Hey, Bing, Yahoo, Google, we're looking for an awesome, clean, architecturally sound solution for taking hundreds of millions of lines of code across several large apps that had been written over 30 years, supporting more than 1 billion documents out there in the wild, and put them on a variety of platforms, form factors, and different API sets, and make them run fantastically well. Can you help, please? The answer was like, go fish in it. Go somewhere else. No, we don't have this kind of a solution. So what do we do? Well, there is no silver bullet solution. There are only actually approaches. And the reason we started with the part where Igor was talking about the brief history and what we've tried with cross-platform is really to answer this. We've learned a lot of things. We carry the scars from it. We still have not learned everything, but we think we're landing on a really good approach. It's all about looking at the trade-offs and the cost and the risks and the benefits. And I'll let Igor now actually take a deep dive into what is the technical strategy that we're taking to get Office on all these platforms. We're going to start now talking about architecture, layers, what works, what doesn't work. Igor, yours.
Hello again. So as Tony said, we are going to deep dive into the technical approaches and trying to avoid solutions as much as possible if I say solution to anything. So just whistle or do something so that I stop. So there are just so many dimensions that we can discuss that doing this in like 2 1-hour talks is just impossible. So we just picked a few topics that we are going to deep dive into and talk about them in more detail. So one is what if you have, and we don't like to call our code base legacy code base, we like to call it legacy rich code base, and I'll talk about some of the distinction a little bit later. And second one is designing platform abstraction layers. And platform abstractions is what you do when you have a shared piece of C++ code and you want to abstract certain OS functionality. So there are different ways to do that, and you will run into different problems depending on how you do that. So we'll talk about the approach that we are using, which is not magical, but it works for us. And then sharing or not sharing UX code. I don't know whether we'll get to it or not, but if you'll get, we'll talk about that. And the last two topics are going to be covered in a second hour. First is the differences in C++ compilers and differences in different platforms. So when you write a lot of C++ code, what are the things that you are running into and how we've dealt with them? And then the second one is you cannot write everything in C++. So some of the platforms, Android uses Java, iOS and OS X use Objective-C. So different techniques that we've used to combine those languages. So the next thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to show a video. Unfortunately, Tony have shown this video to some people that were in the room, so forget what you saw. So this video is a test. So I'll see how many people will guess what point I'm trying to make. It's not very long. And it has music.
Thank you.
So in fact, I didn't even want this video. What I wanted to do is a video of an airplane that is getting rebuilt in flight, because that's how working on a large code base that ships product all the time feels. Couldn't find that, so the video was from 10th Street overpass over the 405 freeway, so just a few hundred feet from here. But the main point is that if you do things carefully, you can take a road that is used by cars all the time, you can build part of the bridge on a site, take your time, and then very quickly replace an old section of a bridge with a new section of a bridge with a very minimum traffic disruption. And that's actually something that we've learned we need to do better and better with our legacy code base. So legacy, the assumption is that legacy is complicated. So I try to figure out some metric to show how complicated some of our apps are. So that's a diagram that I came up with. So again, don't try to read this diagram, like no one can possibly read it. So that's not even interface dependency or function dependency. That's actually build unit dependency of all of the libraries that go into Vert. And the diagram looks nicer than it is, in fact, because it just was generated in a symmetric way. If you've generated it in a different way, where it's by density of the edges, it would look a little bit more complicated. And again, you can say, okay, so you have complicated code and complicated problem, or you can just say that you guys are dumb and you've build something that is too complex. But in any case, if you have something like this and you believe that it has a lot of useful functionalities, then how do you evolve? And there are different techniques. There is not even agreement on our side. From the past, you can see that we've tried just forking the code and having a group of engineers that is focused on a specific platform. That works amazingly well. So MacOffice 98 is a good example of that. For the first year, maybe 2 years. So you get a lot of excitement, you can deliver things quickly, but eventually you need to start merging things and it becomes really, really complicated. So you start spending higher percentage of your engineering time on just porting. And that's no longer fun, and it slows everyone down, and there is weird feature skew between all of the different endpoints that you need to cover. So what we've decided to do about 3 years ago is that we are going to stop all of this. Well, it's impossible to stop it immediately, but what we'll do going forward is that we are going to do all of this work in place. So whatever it takes, you do not get to fork a code base. So we built all of our code in a single build lab. It gets built together for all of the platforms. So there is caveat, it's not 100% true, but almost 100% true. And you just need to figure out how to do it in place. And this means that you need to do refactoring, you need to produce composable components that you can reuse on different platforms. We try to do mechanical refactoring as much as possible. And that's actually one place where C++ is not very strong. We'd love if there were strong refactoring and code analysis tools for C++. It's sort of rudimentary compared to C# and Java. You can do a lot more things if you have complex code base. Sometimes you have to rely on this when you do big architectural changes. Places where we cannot mechanically refactor, we rely on unit testing. And I wish I could say that everything in Office code base is unit tested. We have very high degree of code coverage, but those more component and scenario tests, so we can go through those scenarios, but we do not necessarily validate all of the internal interfaces. For all the places where we refactor now, we do that. It's a requirement. And then we've done a few other fun things. So I think that in the Dropbox presentation, I saw some code that had like lines and lines of nested if defs. So if you have a few tens of thousands of lines of C++ code, and you try to do that, and we've tried to do that in some projects, believe me, the combinatoric complexity of understanding what actually gets compiled from this piece of code for a particular platform becomes beyond the ability of like anyone, even the most genius programmer. So our rules, no platform bound if defs. So you can use that for a little while if you absolutely need to do that, but you need to figure out how you are going to introduce intermediate interface and refactor your code. So that actually worked wonders for us to apply this rule. And no runtime checks. So nowhere we have if iOS do this, if Android do that, if Windows do this. And we keep everything working all the time. So that's actually one of the benefits of having legacy code base. We have Win32 Office that is highly automated. The testing is highly automated, and it's very functional. So it's zero tolerance on breaking anything, zero tolerance on breaking any automation. And what this leads to is a lot of the problems that you get into when you do architectural changes, where again you implement 20%, like 80% of the exciting stuff and 20% of the boring stuff, and then you discover all of the integration points that you broke for the next 2 months or 3 months. So when you have something like that, it's very upfront. And initially people complain because it's a pain in the ass to do that. So people would say that, well, like there is no velocity of innovation, it's so difficult to do that. But when you do that, you are more done than you otherwise would be. And we dog food on all of the platforms all the time. We aspire to dog food every day. We can't, we break, yes, so we dog food a little bit less often, but that's our aspiration. And I think that the two summaries here is that if you have a large code base, it's actually very useful. Like treat it with care, and it's going to help you do work because it's an amazing validation tool for any ideas that you have. Don't try to build new things on the side. Sometimes it's appropriate, but more often than not, doing things in place is just better. And some of those things just force you to do the right thing. I don't know how you guys dealing with the tension between doing better engineering and doing more features. It was always a challenge for all of the teams that I work on. So putting some of the principle like this in place just simplifies this conversation. So we want Office on Android, and we want to continue to ship Office on Android and Office on Win32. That's what we need to do. So that sort of closes some of those conversations. So next 2 minutes, I'm going to explain all of the Office cross-platform architecture with one slide. It's that easy. So Office looks like a big box. And it has a layer on top, layer in the middle, layer at the bottom. And everything that we do is to basically make the box in the middle to be as big as possible. That's our shared core. So Tony was saying that content fidelity is incredibly important for us. Word document should be Word document. Anywhere PowerPoint presentation should be PowerPoint presentation anywhere, unless you use exact same code to open it, layout it, render it, edit it, save it back, talk with the service, it just doesn't work. So we just forced to put all of this code in the middle. All of this code is C++. So we don't use anything else. At various points in time, we had different conversation on should we start using managed languages because it's easier to program. And again, the Dropbox presentation was awesome. Like all of the reasons for why C++ produced a lot of the performance and reliability benefits when going from Java. So those exactly are the reasons why we didn't use Java and C# in the first place. That's very biased towards C++, so don't say that outside of this room. We are in the cloud world, so we are trying to push as much into service, but only where it makes sense. So if users expect offline functionality, we'll build offline code, so then it plays by the client rules. And then we build UI using native UI frameworks. Again, topic of deep religious philosophical debate on whether that's the right thing, because you're basically signing up for building UI for every framework. But again, as Dropbox guys, we've built an internal set of systems for how we make this line very, very thin. And I'll actually show how thin it is. And then at the bottom, we have platform abstraction layer, so places where we actually need to talk to an operating system. And it's very important that there are multiple. Because again, we've tried to have a single one where there is just this Office platform abstraction layer and everything built on top, and that works really badly. And I'll talk about it in a minute on why it works really badly. And sometimes this means that people need to work in all of those layers, and working at the bottom and working at the top basically means that we need to work on multiple platforms. That's a side effect of making this decision, but we are sort of unapologetic about it because it serves our purposes. We want to build the best UI, we want to have the best performance on all of the platforms. We are willing to do that. So, how well does this actually work? because if at the end you can share like 30% of the code, like does it even worth the pain to go through all of this? So this slide is from an architectural review that we did for PowerPoint about 2 weeks ago. So that's real code sharing stats from our code base right now for the Universal app. So that's the new name for the Winner Key, because it runs everywhere. It runs on Xbox, it runs on a phone, it runs on a slate. We can actually share 96% of the code. So if you compare this app with Android app and with Win32 apps, 96% of the code, lines of code compiled into a product are exactly the same lines. And the 4% is what you would expect. It's UI that is written in XAML with a thin C++ layer. We actually don't like how much easier. We want it to be even smaller. If you just look at C++ at 98.6, and actually even for us that was surprising, because we were shooting for something that would be like 90 plus, so that's significantly more. And if you look on Android, and Android shares less code, so that was interesting as well, because it's basically the same design. Why is there 5% of Java code when there is only like 4% of XAML plus C++? But if you look at the C++ sharing, actually it's 99.7. Like 0.3% of the C++ code that goes into Android version of an app is different from a universal app. So again, weird inversion. We actually went and looked at this because it just looked strange. And what we found is that one thing is obvious is UI-related code on Android is, of course, Java. So the sharing of C++ code would be higher, so that's expected. But what we found is we use generated code to bind our view models to UI frameworks, and our Java code generation was just too verbose. And there were some opportunities missed, so we will probably do a little bit better. Another question is, like, if PowerPoint is like 1,000 lines of code, that's, again, isn't worth the effort. So we are not in hundreds, we are in tens of millions of lines of code. So it actually matters for us deeply. So those numbers directly affect our engineering efficiency. So platform abstraction layers. So and how we approach them and things that we've tried that went well and not so well. So long history in the industry, so everyone likes or hates write once, run everywhere frameworks. In general, you take two approaches that apply to a lot of abstraction layers. You try to push your level of abstraction very, very low. Some of them are trying to push this in a code. And if you put it in a code, like obviously you can just write your code in a way that is going to run everywhere. So that's one approach. Another one, like P code, would fall into that category. Another one is you just build a very broad framework, like Silverlight or Flash, where you just can build your apps on top of that. So sounds like a good way to share code? Well, not so much, because what we found is that you always run into what we like to call impedance mismatch. And electrical engineering term, which I think applies to software really well. So you solve impedance mismatch by designing the input impedance of an electric load or the output impedance of corresponding signal source to maximize power transfer or minimize signal reflection. And that describes software better than most of the software descriptions, because what happens there is one of two things. It's either impedance mismatch causes you to blow up because the system doesn't expect and reflect the load, or you cause the system to blow up. And either one of those results in really bad behavior, and that's actually the story of the Word 6.0, because the way we've done it is we just build a Win32 emulator for Mac. And devs who did this thought that they've basically done a feat of engineering, because they've done it with a very small team very quickly, and it was complete enough implementation so that you could like run Word and Excel on top of that thing. And some of the things are obvious, like your UI is just going to look like Windows, so that sucks, that's not what users want. Performance expectations very easily mismatched when you go with an abstraction that is this low. The one that actually beaten us the most is macOS at that time did not have virtual memory. And Windows didn't have very good virtual memory, but it has something. So we've made assumptions that worked perfectly well for Windows world, but they just completely blew in our face on the macOS, just generated straight performance problems. And you've run into minute details of a particular semantic of an API. Like Win32 is especially bad because it's actually underspecified. Even for things like a create file, you need to write a dissertation on what it actually does under the cover. So when you use abstractions like this, so you just run interbox and weird behavior differences that you cannot explain. And you cannot interop with native subsystems. So all of UI is your own. If you want to put system UI in the middle or you want to inject yourself in the middle, it just doesn't work. So we don't do this anymore. So instead of that, actually, that's a nice slide. So that's a quote. So one of the devs who worked on Vert 6 still works actually on iOS work right now, and that's a direct quote from him. The only good thing about beating your head against the wall is that it feels good when you stop. And this is direct reference to the Mac Vert 6.0 experience, because another problem is that you hit one of those bugs as an engineer and you have nothing good that you can do. You can just hack around it and nothing else. And it just doesn't feel very good. But you learn how to do better. So what we do instead is, and again, this stuff might just sound very obvious, but the thing that we've decided is that the only place where we are going to put abstractions is when A, we understand what we are doing, because it's amazing how often we do not understand what our own apps do. So we need to really understand what app is trying to do with a specific layer. And we have to understand how this maps to every single platform that we are targeting. Do not assume that you understand how it's going to work on Android. Do not assume how it's going to work on iOS. Actually, go and learn how they work. And we are willing to sacrifice code sharing for this because that matters for the experience. If you need to write platform-specific code, we'll do that. And we are willing to redesign our own code as well. And I'll give you an example of this. So one more specific example is composition and animation. So if you think about any Office app, Word, PowerPoint, Excel, so it's editor, so it's a fairly complex custom rendering. It's a bunch of stuff that gets layered on top of each other. And we need to animate it. So if you've used Office 2013 or iPad, all of the content is interactive and animatable. And with touch devices, so we need to respond to touch really quickly, and touch, in a sense, it's a super quick real-time input and animations so that you can bounce stuff around and produce different physics. So that's what our canvases do. And when you need to make something like that to be cross-platform and share as much of the app code as possible, like the first thing that people say is that, okay, so we should take OpenGL or we should take DirectX, make your choice. And we're just going to write everything on top of them. It's hardware accelerated, it's super fast, just going to write to that and then everything works. Actually, it doesn't, because that's effectively what Java is trying to do, and that's effectively what Silverlight tried to do, and Flash tried to do. It's except that it's C++ as a runtime, because you're going to run into all of the same issues with impedance mismatch. We've actually written one compositor ourselves, because on Windows 7, there is no compositor. On Windows 8, there is one, so since we want to work on Windows 7, we've written one ourselves on top of DirectX, and the thing that we've learned is that those APIs are fantastic, but you need to be an expert, and even if you're an expert, you're going to run into all of the differences between GPUs, video drivers. One thing that is fast on one GPU with one video driver is not fast on another device. And there are bugs because those are complex APIs. And we are a relatively big engineering organization, but even for us, it's not sustainable to have a group of developers who can track the ecosystem. It just doesn't work. And that was just Windows, one version of Windows, albeit very widely used one. So no, we didn't like that. So what we've done instead is we actually took those people who built the Win32 compositor, because the most important thing about the experience was is they've learned what our applications do. So after we've done this work, we actually finally understood, okay, so now we know how many layers Word would create and Excel would create, and what is the update logic, and how all of the virtualization should work, and how many animations we are going to create at the same time. Before that, we really didn't know. It was just write a bunch of code, test it and hope that it works, profile it and do all of the good engineering thing, but really didn't have a deep understanding. So they took all of this knowledge, looked at the core animation, looked at Android, looked at decomp and XAML. And what we've discovered is that, and that's a common theme for all of the PALs, is that operating systems are not developed in a vacuum. Those, like, people who work on compositors are a small group of people, and people who work on graphics, so they roughly build the same stuff. It's similar in many aspects. So you could look at it and say that, okay, so we can define an interface which we think is going to match what we need and what they give to us. So that's great. So that helps. But another thing that we've discovered is that they use completely different threading model, and there are completely different expectations on where you're going to render stuff and how you're going to push it to your compositor. So the things that we've done, and that's sort of a nice example of how we've developed one of those mini PALs, is, and it's sort of hard to understand it, but really the only thing that you need to see is that so the vertical lines is Win32, XAML, Android, iOS. So the horizontal lines, and then the vertical boxes are basically subsystems that we build that are the same boxes for all of the platforms. So there is a shared code on the left. Then there is an actual API that all of the shared code is going to call, which is completely shared. So we call it front end. And then there is a set of channels, which are asynchronous channels that you can use to push data across thread boundaries. And all of the communication is asynchronous that goes to core animation, Android, WinRT, and our custom backend. The shading behind that is actually three different threads. So on the right is a composition thread, so that's the thing that in case of Win32, that's our own thread. In case of other platforms, that's actually inside the OS. If you want to be precise, some of them are in a separate process. So the slightly lighter shade of gray, that's actually UI thread. So that's the code that we run on a UI thread. And the white one is the application thread. So each thread has each operating system has a different combination of what runs where. And we've just went and redesigned all of our code so that we don't make any synchronous assumptions. And this way we've managed to keep the same box with the same performance expectations between all of those platforms and sort of get awesome performance and responsiveness on all of them. And we've obviously learned a lot about the OS's core animation is awesome. Apple done an amazing job. It's actually kind of spectacular how good it is. So if you look at Android and how much stuff they do on UI thread, you learn that, well, they already do that enough stuff on the UI thread that if we do anything at all, we just don't work. So we had to move all of our code away from the UI thread, which is painful, but we want our apps to work well. And then on WinRT, we've done the same thing, but mostly because we really want to be awesome, and since we've already learned to not be on a UI thread, let's just not be on the UI thread. So that's one example. I had one more example to actually talk about how we are making sure that the UI line at the top of the shaded box is as thin as possible. In a nutshell, is we use MVVM model, where our models and our view models are all shared code. We use CodeGen to bind to OS-specific APIs. But I think that what I'll do is I'll stop because I have exactly 1 minute before the end, and I'll answer questions instead of trying to rush. So for the Apple platform right now, and like Tony can answer this question more precisely, the numbers are not going to look as good, and the reason for why they are not as good is because when you exist, things are more difficult. Because for Apple we already had a product, so we've sort of accumulated the debt. So we'll aspire to get Apple platforms to where we are with Android, Win32, and WinRT.
So the iOS Alpha's app, which got great reviews, by the way, great job there. They were mostly
desktop platform doing? So
yes.
Yes. And they actually share a lot of code with Win32 as well. It's just it's the code sharing is not as direct, so the percentage is not going to look like, I don't know the exact percentage, but it still would be high.
So if you saw the bigger slide earlier, the Mac code base was forked in 98.
Yeah.
And there were benefits to that, negatives to that, yeah. And we're currently bringing that back to the common line. So at the moment, the actual sharing numbers are lower than the Android work, because that's just happening directly out of the same Windows line.
Technically, the code is still forked.
Technically, it is still forked, although it is converging.
The iPad app is part of that Mac fork.
Yeah. So iPad and Mac, they ship from the same source code. Okay. And what Igor is talking about is in a separate sort of separate branch for Android and Windows and web. And a lot of core shared C++ is common flowing between them.
So is there a lot of sharing or more sharing between the iPad and the Mac than between, say, Android and Windows? Is it about the same?
Depending on how you look at it,
if you
squint, a lot of it is shared across all the platforms.
Yeah,
it's just we may have a slightly different
those two platforms,
fork of it.
Is there a lot of commonality in those two?
Well, naturally there is, because you have the programming language that is common, particularly for your UX frameworks.
Yeah.
It's both Objective-C. So naturally you'd be like, well, yeah, I can share some UX frameworks and stuff.
That's why I'm asking the question.
Yeah, versus between Android, oh, this is Java, no, on Windows, this is XAML and C++, right?
Yeah.
And the mini pals are actually a lot the same, because at the low level between iOS and OS X, the APIs are about 85% the same. Yeah, the phone has a radio interface layer, iPad does not have it. Maybe soon with the continuing stuff that they're doing on Apple, they'll have it. But about 80% of the APIs are the same. Yeah. So it's easier. That is not the case for Windows 32 and Windows RT.
No, they're pretty different.
They're close to zero.
Yeah.
it's not exactly zero.
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah, I looked at Win RT and
out of curiosity, what do you guys use it for source control?
Source Depot. So it's called Source Depot.
It's your internal one.
It's an internal one. It's
souped up version of Source Depot.
Yeah.
Can you say a little more about what's in the UI layer on the Win32 desktop?
So on the UI layer on Win32 desktop, we've built our complete UI framework ourselves. So it obviously lives in an HMIN because you cannot not live in an HMIN, but if you look at Office 2013, for example, like you can't build this on top of user 32.
So are you saying it's essentially DirectX, or is it using the data controls?
It's a combination, again, similar to Dropbox, for example, edit boxes. We actually share edit boxes because you don't want edit box to behave in a different way, and we actually share this code. But for a lot of other controls, yeah, so this is a custom control framework on top of DirectX and on top of the compositor that I've mentioned. So if you look at what we have inside, is actually very similar to XAML or Coca and Core Animation. And again, we don't live in a vacuum, so we'll look at what people are doing. And
we should probably now take the break, and then we have almost a full hour. When are we starting? 4:30 or 4:45?
4:45.
4:45. It's a deep dive in a lot of source code.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.